Hi everyone, I hope you're enjoying the conference so far. My name is Alyson Van Natto, and I'm going to talk about how hybridization varies geographically in Abronia umbellata. This is work I did with Chris Acker at Queen's University during my master's. For some background, I'm going to start with the abundant center and center periphery hypotheses. The abundant center hypothesis claims that a species should be most abundant in the center of its range, which is represented by this large blue unicorn, and this is because conditions are most optimal, and it should become less abundant towards range edges. The center periphery hypothesis is an extension of the abundant center hypothesis and claims that if populations are smaller and more isolated towards range edges, then they should be lower in genetic variation and higher in genetic differentiation because of genetic drift and a lack of gene flow. And because of this lack of genetic variation, these populations may not be able to adapt to conditions beyond the range. However, there may be gene flow with these range edge populations, just not with the same species. So I'm just going to go over hybridization and introgression. Hybridization in this example is the interbreeding of two species to create this genetically intermediate hybrid. Introgression would be if this hybrid backcrossed to a parental species to create individuals that were mostly genetically one species but had alleles of another species. Okay, like I said, hybridization or gene flow from another species may help one species expand its range. So back to our example before, we have the blue species, center edge, and it's unable to adapt to beyond edge conditions. But this time it's co-occurring with a pink unicorn congener. And this congener is at its center of its range where the blue species is at the range edge. According to the abundant center hypothesis, this should be the most optimal habitat for the pink species. So if there's gene flow between the pink species and the blue species, seen here, the pink species may provide beneficial alleles or just genetic variation that the blue species can use to expand its range. However, hybridization between these two species might be of consequence to the blue species as well. An example of a consequence associated with hybridization is demographic swamping, which is the reduction of population growth rate due to the production of maladapted hybrids. This may result in population extinction and range contraction. Another example is genetic swamping, in which there's so much backcrossing with these hybrids to the pink species that the pink species starts to assimilate the blue species. And once again, the range might contract. To determine if any of these scenarios are occurring though, we need to quantify hybridization across the species range, which is rarely done. I decided to do this with Abronia umbellata. Abronia umbellata is a coastal dune plant that ranges from Baja California to Coos Bay, Oregon, and then has disjunct populations in Washington and in British Columbia. And what's interesting about Abronia umbellata is that it co-occurs with two other coastal Abronia species, Abronia latifolia and Abronia maritima. Abronia latifolia and Abronia maritima, though, are parapatric with each other and only co-occur at two locations near Point Conception, California. But you can see that the range of Abronia latifolia and Abronia maritima overlap with the entire range of Abronia umbellata. And what's interesting is that all these species hybridize, and they're quite obvious and easy to find in the field. So this is a hybrid between Abronia umbellata and Abronia maritima. So you can see Abronia maritima has these really tight umbels, and Abronia umbellata has these wide umbels. And then this hybrid is quite intermediate in shape between the two. It's the same with color. This is Abronia umbellata, light pink with these white eye spots. This is Abronia maritima, magenta with no eye spot. And then the hybrids are a medium pink color with the white eye spot. So like I said, I want to quantify hybridization across the range of Abronia umbellata. But first I had to keep in mind the mating system shift in Abronia umbellata. Abronia umbellata has two varieties. Variety umbellata that occurs south of San Francisco. It is self-incompatible and entirely outcrossing. And then variety breviflora occurs north of San Francisco and is self-compatible and predominantly selfing. And many of the populations of variety breviflora are at risk. Abronia umbellata is listed as endangered in Washington, British Columbia, and Oregon, and the species is a special concern in California. And we suspected that the predominantly selfing nature of variety breviflora may prevent hybridization because rather than outcrossing with an individual of the same species or another species, these individuals are selfing. So with all this in mind, I had a couple questions. The first is, to what extent is there hybridization and integration among Abronia umbellata and its congeners? And how does this vary geographically? And the second is hybridization less frequent with the southern variety of Abronia umbellata. To answer these questions, I surveyed 37 populations across the range of Abronia umbellata. From each population, I took morphological measurements from 20 individuals per species. And then I also took leaf material and used some of that leaf material in genetic analyses. I sequenced 4 individuals per species per population. I have 5 single copy genes and 1 chloroplast gene. And with the nuclear genes, I was left 209 SNPs. So for the rest of the talk, Abronia latifolia is going to be associated with the color green, Abronia umbellata with pink, and Abronia maritima with blue. So like I said, there's 37 populations. Some populations only had 1 species present, and some had more than one. And you can see here, there's only 1 population that had all 3 present, and that's near Point Conception in California. So the first thing I want to do was look at hybrid occurrence frequency. And so this is hybrids by appearance rather than by genetics. So the first thing I did was extensive searches. So at each population we went to, I looked around for hybrids. And then the other method was using radius plots. So like I said, I took morphological measurements from 20 individuals per species. And from those 20 focal plants per species, I did these 3-meter radius plots around them and recorded the presence or absence of another species or hybrid within that plot. So this is what I found. These are the 25 populations of Abronia umbellata, or 25 populations that had Abronia umbellata present. These are the populations that had another Abronia species present. So you can see most of them. And then these are the populations that I found hybrids when doing extensive searches. So there's 9 populations, which is 42.8% of those 25 populations. And then with the radius plots, I only found hybrid at 28.6% of the populations, or 6 of them. But what's most interesting here is that all the hybrids I found were within the outcrossing varieties populations and none within the selfing variety populations. So I didn't find any morphological hybrids with selfing individuals. Okay, once I did this, I want to use genetics to see if I could find hybrids genetically. So I'm going to start with the results I found with the chloroplast gene. I used MAT-K. So this is just an example of a minimum spanning network. Each pie chart here represents a haplotype, and the dashes between each pie chart here are the number of mutations between these haplotypes. And the colors within each circle are individuals that were morphologically identified as that individual. So pink individuals were morphologically identified as Abronia umbellata, blue individuals identified as Abronia maritima, and so on. So this is an example of what a minimum spanning network might look like if there was introgression and it was obvious. So what we know about chloroplast genes is that they're maternally inherited. So imagine that there was hybridization between Abronia umbellata and Abronia maritima. And the hybrid had Abronia umbellata as a mother, so it has Abronia umbellata's chloroplast haplotype, but then it kept backcrossing to Abronia maritima. And so Abronia maritima was the paternal parent. In this case, individuals may start looking more and more like Abronia maritima, so this magenta flower, rather than Abronia umbellata, but they would still have the maternal haplotype of Abronia umbellata. Thus, we would identify them as Abronia maritima, but they would have this haplotype, and so they'd end up in this circle. This is what we might see if there is no introgression or nucleocytoplasmic incompatibilities. And nucleocytoplasmic incompatibilities in this case is the incompatibilities between the nuclear genome and the chloroplast genome. So imagine again with the Abronia umbellata and Abronia maritima hybrid that these F1 hybrids that have Abronia umbellata as a maternal parent cannot backcross to Abronia maritima because the chloroplast genome of Abronia umbellata is not compatible with the nuclear genome of Abronia maritima. Okay, so like I said, this could indicate no introgression or these incompatibilities. What might be happening is, say, these hybrids between Abronia umbellata and Abronia maritima are only able to backcross to their maternal parent, which in this case would be Abronia umbellata. If they're backcrossing to Abronia umbellata, they're just going to look more and more like Abronia umbellata and then still end up in this Abronia umbellata haplotype. Okay, so what did I find? I found something similar to either no introgression or these nucleocytoplasmic incompatibilities. You can see that there isn't any green or blue within this pink circle here, or pink in here, or green or pink in here. So I want to investigate this further and determine if there was introgression. So I moved on to the nuclear genes. this is a principal components analysis, and it's taking those 200, the variation found in those 209 SNPs and just breaking them down to less axes so I am able to plot them like this. But what you need to know is that each point represents an individual, and the color of the individual, or the color of the point, is what the individual was identified as in the field. So dark blue individuals are Abronia maritima, green individuals are Abronia latifolia, and pink individuals are Abronia umbellata. And then you can see these hybrids here. There's hybrids between Abronia umbellata and Abronia maritima, which I labeled as MA, and then hybrids between Abronia umbellata and Abronia latifolia, which I labeled as LA. And you can see that they're intermediate between the two groups, but they're more they're clustering more closely with Abronia umbellata, which may indicate backcrossing to Abronia umbellata and thus introgression. So I want to look at this further, so I did a new hybrids analysis. And this figure might be a bit complicated, so I'm just going to walk you through it. This is another principal components analysis, but it only has Abronia umbellata and Abronia maritima in it. So points that are closer together are more genetically similar, and points that are far away are more genetically dissimilar. And the color of each point is what new hybrids identified the individual as. So here we have pure Abronia maritima, and then we have pure Abronia umbellata. Oh, and sorry, I forgot to mention, new hybrids uses posterior probabilities to assign individuals to certain groups. So the groups are pure parental species, F1 hybrids, F2 hybrids, or backcrosses to either species. So this is what new hybrids identified as pure parental species, Abronia umbellata and Abronia maritima. And then this is what new hybrids identified as F1 hybrids. So you can see that they're really intermediate between Abronia umbellata and Abronia maritima, these green squares. And it also found Abronia umbellata backcrosses, but did not find any Abronia maritima backcrosses. So that's represented by these red diamonds. And you can see that they're clustering more closely with Abronia umbellata. And we found the same result for hybrids between Abronia umbellata and Abronia latifolia. We found no hybrids that were backcrossed to Abronia latifolia. And we actually found no F1 or F2 hybrids either. And like I said, you can see that these backcrosses to Abronia umbellata are clustering more closely with Abronia umbellata. And then this is Abronia latifolia. Okay, so what did we find? So my first question, to what extent is there hybridization and introgression among Abronia umbellata and its congeners? And how does this vary geographically? We found that hybridization is frequently found in outcrossing populations of Abronia umbellata, and backcrossing may occur more into Abronia umbellata than its congeners. And two, is hybridization less frequent with the selfing variety of Abronia umbellata? Simple answer is yes. We didn't find any morphological hybrids and no hybrids genetically either. And with that, I'd like to thank my supervisor and our funding sources and all the parks that we got to visit looking for this wonderful plant. And with that, I'll take any questions. Thank you.